Hey, I'm John Satram.
And I'm Nick Breeze.
We're running an event series called D.R.E.A.M, or Data Rules Everything Around Me, presented by Mozilla in partnership with Netizen.
The internet. Technology we're all growing increasingly dependent on, yet remains a pretty cloudy concept for most of us. If asked to imagine the internet, you might think of your favorite memes, or the websites you visit, or the apps that you use.
Behind the cat gifs, DMs, and streaming content is real physical infrastructure connected to massive data centers through a network of stakeholders that we rarely see.
But fortunately, there exist punk cartographers painstakingly mapping out this complex terrain for the rest of us. One such internet explorer is Ingrid Burrington, who's been researching internet infrastructure for years. And the output of that research takes on many different forms, from articles in The Atlantic to art on gallery walls.
We recently took a walk with Ingrid to explore Chicago's physical infrastructure. By noticing tangible fragments of the cloud around us, we can see past the marketing metaphors, expand the narrative, and ask different questions about the internet at large.
It was really important to me when I was doing a lot of the work behind what became the field guide to think about it as a field guide and not as an atlas. I initially thought, oh, perhaps I can make a map, and then it became very clear that it was much more interesting to give people the means to make their own maps. A thing that happens when artists make work around or write about or talk about otherwise obscured or ignored landscapes is that there's a tendency to sort of view those places as somehow having been conquered, right? Like, now we've all seen it, hats off to you, the usually a man who has like seen the hidden thing, well done. It makes me uneasy, one, because I feel like it kind of reinforces a lot of the colonial narratives that underpin like how we live with computation. And two, it pushes people away from actually kind of wanting to have their own embodied relationship with technologies. The decision, yeah, to write a field guide, so like, here's what to look for, and letting people kind of become experts themselves rather than like turning to me, the expert, I think is really powerful. And it's one of the most like delightful things to have come out of this project has definitely been people in other cities telling me that they're like doing this in their town or making their own like kind of local infrastructure field guides and learning about their own city in this totally different way. I always think these look like TIE fighters. Yeah, right? Yeah. It's like if prehistoric cave people drew TIE fighters. And this indicates like the width of the duct that we're standing over right now. Technologies that are supposed to kind of connect people across great distances so often just focus on urban cores and sort of reinforce the existing strands of like commerce and really miss the opportunity to support people who like already don't have a lot of resources. There's this tiny little town on the California coast, like a little south of Mendocino, and it's home to a submarine cable landing station. So there's a cable that runs from this point, you know, at the tip of Northern California out to Japan and Hawaii. And the towns near it, they're like, I think it's, you know, they're all about like 600 people-ish. And nobody has good internet access. Like you can see the like little posts for like the fiber optic cable routes that are running down most of the main streets in these towns. And at no point did anyone think perhaps we should make this like available to the public that lives here. And every effort to try and kind of like make inroads with that has been met with like fierce opposition because companies like AT&T don't see any kind of financial incentives doing lots of like trenching and extra like kind of construction and physical labor to serve 600 people. And it's just a tremendously kind of unfair scenario. Well, I don't really think we're at that stage yet as a society. The idea that places like data centers and subsea cable landing stations, which are all privately owned, should be reevaluated in terms of their public service or thought about as things that the public has some right to understand, some right to engage with, some right to kind of know is really important. What they're doing still should be something that like people are allowed to kind of like peer into and question, especially question and kind of have a relationship with that's not just sort of like oohing and aahing at like the server racks. Whenever we start talking about technology, computation, and networks, We're really talking about power, because being able to reach lots of people very quickly, like, is an instrument of power. Being able to move time and space in, like, a radically different way than nature would let you is an act of power. When this stuff stays really opaque or abstracted in a metaphor, it becomes a lot easier to retain a particular narrative of power. There's sort of an assumption that that this is just how things are, and that they couldn't be built differently, negotiated differently, experienced differently. And the second you actually start to ask those questions, you can start to even have other imaginaries.